Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
It's the night before Christmas, and the Flames have had an interesting week, being handed their Christmas gift with a win over the Jets. As usual, it's me and Matt here to recap the week for everybody. Matt, how you doing?
Good. Ready for the holiday season, Dan?
I am. It's Christmas time. I'm off for the rest of the year. It's nice, and it looks like it's going to be a white Christmas in Calgary, which is nice. There's snow on the ground.
Definitely a departure from pretty much everywhere else in North America.
Yeah, we've had just enough snow to get it on the ground and keep it on the ground for Christmas, and I hope that that's going to be the little bit of snow that we get this year. Well, Matt, we've had a busy week of Flames hockey. Why don't we start, as usual, by breaking that down? This was the dreaded road trip, the road trip that we were all worried about. The Flames took their win streak and put it on the line away from the Dome, and we had some mixed results. If we take a look at the games, the Flames went to Nashville, and they played against the Predators. They won 2-1. I wasn't surprised. We both thought the Flames would probably win this game. I just thought that they would have that momentum behind them and be able to take it onto the road trip. Not a very high-scoring game, very much like the games that we used to see from the Flames where they were always winning by one goal. What were your thoughts on this game?
I thought it was very much a Nashville Predators game. Usually our games are very low-scoring, and it's more of a chess match style of game, not a run-and-gun game. I was a little concerned, though, at the beginning with the Flames running around their own zone.
Yeah.
Like, that was not what we've seen from the team all through the first few weeks of December.
No, I agree. I was kind of watching that game at the beginning, and yeah, you could tell Nashville was definitely taking over. And to me, I thought that it was a good show by the Flames to show that they could regain their composure. So often in the early part of this season, we saw another team would start having their way with us, and we just shut it down and stop playing. So I thought for the Flames to come back and sort of get their game back later on, it really showed some mental toughness there that we haven't seen so much from this team this year.
Yeah, when Cody Hodgson was awarded that penalty shot and he scored, I was like, is the rails going to come off this team now? And they pretty much stopped Nashville from that point forward, which was nice to see.
Yeah, Nashville got out early, and then they were able to, and I don't know if it was Hartley, you know, making adjustments with the team or what it was, but yeah, they definitely ended up coming up and starting to shut them down. I think they let up a little bit in the third period, and I think from what I was seeing, we were lucky that Nashville didn't get another one there.
True, but having Kari Ramo starting to play at his best level, you can actually rely on him now to make saves, where early in the season, that wasn't the case.
Yeah, he's starting to look like a starting goaltender now, isn't he?
Which will do nothing but help the team going forward.
And we'll talk more about it later, but just as an interesting note, he debuted some interesting new goalie pads in this game, where he looked eerily similar to Mika Kiprusoff. If you didn't know any better, you'd think Kipper came out of retirement for a night. So, Matt, any other thoughts on the Predators game? To me, it was just kind of a ho-hum game, not a lot to say about it.
Pretty much. Other than TJ Brody, like, he was the one that caused the penalty shot by taking the penalty, and then he scored the tying goal, which I thought that was a fitting redemption for him.
And, of course, the Flames won in overtime. It went to overtime, and the Flames won, but for once, it wasn't Gaudreau that scored. Gaudreau just got the assist on that one.
Yeah, big deal. You know, anytime it goes to 3-on-3, it's going to be the Gaudreau show and the game will end.
For sure. The Flames then went, the next game they played was against the Dallas Stars. And this was one I was worried about because we saw the Flames, I wouldn't say school Dallas, but they got behind here at the Dome to start the whole home win streak against Dallas, managed to come back and really muscle their way into a win against the Stars. So I thought the Stars were going to be looking for vengeance. But this game, the Flames, I think, they didn't play 60 minutes, but I thought that they played the better overall game in this one.
For a game against the best team in the league, I thought the Flames handled the Stars quite effectively and pretty much limited them to as minimal of chances that you could possibly contain them.
Yeah, this was definitely a Calgary Flames game, I thought. You know, you could tell they knew the Stars. They knew what to expect from the Stars. The Stars didn't give them anything unexpected. And like you said, they knew how to limit their chances. And the Stars still outshot us 36-27, but the Flames, I think, were in control almost right from the beginning here.
I can't argue with that. The Flames seemed to, like, after getting abused by both Ben and Seguin a few years ago, they've seemed to key in on them specifically and try to interrupt their play specifically. And in each of the games against the Stars, they managed to hold both of them off the score sheet, which is a feat in of itself.
For sure. And it is a feat in of itself. And I think it's, I don't know if it was the Stars underestimating the Flames or what's going on, but you could definitely tell here that the Flames just came out and controlled it. It's almost like the Stars said, it doesn't really matter at the beginning, we can get this back, and never did. And I think you saw that in Calgary too. They let up after a while in the home game, and the Flames capitalized.
An example of having a lack of mental fortitude.
For sure. A note on these games, I don't think we covered this last week, but Michael Frolik is scratched with an injury and has been for the road trip. It's being classified as an unspecified upper body injury.
Yeah, it was a shoulder, though. You could tell when he...
Yeah, you could tell, but the official listing just upper body.
Yeah, he missed a hit in Nashville and looked to have separated his shoulder or something along those lines.
And if it's a separated shoulder, he could be out for the rest of the year.
Probably not, though. Like the way they were describing it, it was like a week-to-week injury, not a indefinite.
Well, that's good. But you could definitely, you could feel that he was missed on the team during these games.
Oh, for sure. Like, the Flames are already weak on the right side to begin with, and you take away arguably their best and most consistent guy thus far this season, it will hurt quite a bit.
Yeah. And I think more, not so much even on the offensive side, but just taking away their most complete forward. In my eyes, Frolik has been the best all-around forward. Not necessarily the best offensive power, but he's the best two-way guy. He's scored when he needs to. He's playing every role of whatever's needed from him.
Can't argue with that.
The next game was the matinee game, the one that we knew the Flames probably wouldn't do well on because it's in the afternoon. Matt, do you know what our stats are on the matinee games? I just know that we never do well.
It's pretty much you can guarantee a loss. I think the last time they won in the afternoon was a game against the Florida Panthers at the beginning of last season, and pretty much like the last few years prior to that, every matinee game's been terrible.
And then you combine that with the fact that we were in St. Louis, which everybody talks about the Honda Center curse, but we haven't won in St. Louis in a while either, have we?
Yeah, since April Fool's Day on 2011.
There you go.
So 6 games in a row. Not good.
And this one was a 3-2 win for the St. Louis Blues. I think that our goalie really kept this one close for us. To me, this was a St. Louis game all the way.
Actually, outside of the first 3 minutes when the Flames scored the first 2 goals, I thought Calgary pretty much controlled the game and just kept taking it to St. Louis. They just weren't effective in the initiating the comeback in totality.
Interesting. Yeah, because, I saw St. Louis score the 2 early, and to me it looked like they deflated the Flames a little bit. Then the Flames, you're right, they did try to come back, but it almost seemed like the Blues, it was almost like a cat playing with its mouse to me.
Yeah.
Like, okay, you guys, you've come back a little bit, now we're going to, throw you back down. And, okay, that's enough, and they'd kind of take the gas out of the Flames again.
Well, it is Ken Hitchcock being the coach of the Blues. You know that they're going to be a defensive shell, so anytime they get a 2 or 3 goal lead.
Yeah, so, but I was glad to see the Flames were able to get 2 in the third there from Monahan and Giordano, because I think that if it would have been a 3-0 game, we all would have been really upset.
Mm-hmm. And it's one of those things, you're not going to win every game. but they did play well outside of the first 3 minutes. And if you can play like that, most games you're going to win. Unfortunately, you know, they're going up against one of the teams that they both suck against and is one of the better teams in the league. So, not much you can do.
And that game ended the 7-game win streak that the Flames had going, which they extended onto the road. The next night, they traveled to Detroit to take on the Red Wings in a back-to-back and ended up losing again 4-2 to the Red Wings. Not surprised. The Red Wings are a tough team. But what I was surprised about is I think for the second back-to-back in a row, they've played Ramo both nights.
I think the Flames are pretty much done with alternating goalies, and I wouldn't really expect Jonas Hiller to get more than 5 or 10 starts the rest of the way.
I agree with you, but I think, you know, I don't know, on a back-to-back, it's sort of customary that you do that, and if he's not the guy, maybe we, I don't know, need to find somebody else.
That will possibly come in the nearer future, depending on what's available on the trade market. I know the Flames have been sniffing around Jonathan Bernier to see if they could acquire him, so who knows?
Well, you know, and I think even if you needed to, I mean, it would take a little bit of maneuvering, but you could put Hiller on waivers. If he clears, you could just bring Ordeo up, let him play one game on a back-to-back, send him back down.
Yeah, Ordeo hasn't played really well in Stockton, though, either, so...
No. But and we've talked about it. I think, you know, Ordeo's a slow starter, and he just needs to work through this, whether it's in the AHL or the NHL.
Yeah, if...
I mean, he's only played, what, like 10 or 12 games down there?
Yeah, if he picks it up in January, because that's when Stockton starts playing more regularly, that you might see him work out of his funk down there, and... If that's the case, then at that point is when I'd bring him up. But just basically leave the situation as it is for the time being and let it sort itself out.
Your thoughts on the Detroit Red Wings game?
Well, I found it interesting. The Flames finally scored a power play goal, and then they just stopped playing the rest of the period. And that's what cost them the game.
I thought it was also interesting that the first power play goal is also Dennis Weidman's first goal of the year.
Well, in the game day preview article, I had specifically called Weidman out, and sure enough, he scored. Just a weird coincidental thing.
Yeah. I think in this game, I was starting to notice more than I had the rest of the road trip, Michael Ferland starting to play Michael Ferland's game again. We started to see that sort of sandpaper guy in Ferland. I think he's tried to get it going earlier, but, I mean, he hasn't played a lot of hockey, and I think it might have taken him a little bit of time to get going. What were your thoughts on Ferland on the road trip?
The type of game he plays, in order for him to be good, he needs to hit everybody. And if he doesn't hit anybody, then you don't notice him, and you could just put anybody else in the lineup. But if he does hit people too regularly, he also could get injured. So it's one of those fine lines of trying to be effective while being chaotic. And it's taken him a while to find that fine balance of being able to hit people with regularity but not going over the line and doing it too often so he gets hurt.
Any other thoughts on the Red Wings game?
Not really. The Flames, it's one of those things. Anytime that you have a protracted winning streak like the Flames did, usually you drop a couple of games before you sort yourself out again. Usually you don't lose one game and then like go on and win another 4 or 5 in a row. Very rarely.
And I mean,
that
was also the second of a back-to-back, so I wasn't expecting a whole lot out of it.
No. And plus, in the 5 games, if you count the New York Rangers game, the last one at home prior to this, all 5 of those games were against the top teams in the league. So each one of those games was going to be a difficult contest regardless.
Yeah, and when you play the St. Louis Blues, too, I mean, it's not an easy game to play. So to have to play the next night against Detroit, who's also not an easy team, it doesn't surprise me that we struggled against Detroit.
No, And even a team like Dallas would struggle against teams like St. Louis and Detroit because the quality of competition is right at the top level. So the fact that we got 0 points out of those four, it's not a big deal, especially with them winning the first three games out of that five-game stretch.
Yeah. And then the Flames came home, back to the Dome, back here in Calgary to the Sea of Red, and not a lot of people were sure what to expect. They were taking on Western Canadian rival, the Winnipeg Jets, and got their home record better and got their streak going again as we beat the Jets 4-1. And to me, this game was all Calgary. I mean, Winnipeg did not look like they showed up to play.
No, I thought that was the most complete performance by the Flames this season. They pretty much kept Winnipeg to the sides throughout the game. Winnipeg, whenever they did get a scoring chance, the Flames would just like stop it and then carry on and take it back to the Winnipeg end.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, we can fault Winnipeg. I mean, they weren't ready to play in the Calgary game. I didn't think they were ready to play in the Edmonton game, but yeah, I think you're right. Calgary played their best complete effort, and I think they also played, to me, their most strategic game. Like, everybody seemed to know exactly what to do and when to do it.
Mm-hmm.
It almost seemed like they were just executing a, you know, like a plan that Hartley had given them ahead of time.
Well, Winnipeg, they're a very big and physical team, and the Flames didn't really engage too much in the physical game. They just skated by them, and were ignoring opportunities at times to throw the big check just to pester the team instead of attacking in that way. You don't ever want to get into playing the other team's game if you can, and the Flames just kept playing their game and wore them down.
And we were talking about him earlier, but I think that Michael Ferland, because as you were saying, Winnipeg is a bigger team, a more physical team, I thought Ferland looked really good in this game.
I agree. In the third period, he did get clocked, though, by one of the Jets players, which was unusual to see him getting hit hard, but
but that's going to happen when you play that style of a game.
True.
You know, I mean, you've got to be able to give and you've got to be able to receive.
True.
So I thought he looked really good, and of course, this game we got the Johnny Gaudreau hat trick. Three of the four goals came from Gaudreau. The first one, the second one, and the third one.
No, the third and fourth.
Oh, right. Sorry. The first, the third, and the fourth. The second one came from Joe Colborn. Good to see Colborn scoring again.
Yeah, good tip by him.
Yeah, it was. And Matt, I think if we, you know, going on sort of the Gaudreau angle. We were talking about this a little bit before we came on the road or on the air tonight. When was the last time we saw a player like this in Calgary? I mean, this kid is dynamic. He's not like Jerome McGinley, where he's a one-way player, where you know what you've got. He seems to be able to do everything, and he seems to have, I think, the best hockey sense we've seen from a Flame in a long time.
Yeah, like with McGinley, you knew he was going to take a slap shot sooner or later, and that's how he would score because he has just that good of a slap shot. But Gaudreau, he can beat you in pretty much every single way. If you give him time, he'll either deke the goalie out, he'll pick a corner, or he'll make this blind pass where nobody sees the lane there and he'll find the guy that's wide open. It's unusual to see somebody that good anyway, and the fact that he's a Flame just makes it all that more awesome.
Yeah, and you know, I mean, we look, and sometimes you get, and we talked about this when the Flames traded Jerome McGinley away, but sometimes you get sort of caught up in your own hype as a team of, okay, this guy's good, and we think he's good, but when you talk to other markets, they go, you know what, the guy's not really that good, but everyone I've talked to in every market says we've got a real star in our hands here, and to be as young as he is and be that star, this is the guy the Flames have to build around for years to come.
Yeah, and realistically, the next thing that the Flames need to do is find a sniper-type guy to put with Gaudreau, either as a center or as a right winger, and somebody that can just fire the pucks in on the excellent passes that he throws.
See, and I think that Monahan is a good fit with him. Like, I think we found a good pairing there. I think that could be Monahan. I think they just need to work with him a little bit to change up his game.
Yeah. Well, if the Flames could back up the Brinks truck and bring Stamkos in, that would be perfect, too.
Yeah, I don't know that we want to spend that kind of money, though.
No. Oddly enough, the two guys that would make the most sense to piggyback on that would be Mike Camilleri and Jerome Iginla, coincidentally, but...
That's not going to happen.
No, unfortunately.
But if you think when Jerome was here, I mean, every year we'd say, okay, Jerome is doing okay, but he'd do better if he had a center. Oh, Jerome's doing well, we brought in this new center. Oh, that didn't work. Oh, we brought in this other guy, it didn't work. We now have that pairing. I believe, in my estimation anyways, that Gaudreau-Monahan is that winger-center pairing, and I think you got to keep them both around long-term.
Oh, yeah. Easily, the Flames should sign them both for, like, 8-year deals at whatever it takes.
Yeah. And interesting note that game gave us Johnny Gaudreau's 100th point in the league. I couldn't believe that when I heard it, because he's been around so little time in this league, but that just shows what a dynamic player he is to have so many goals. This is, what, his fourth year?
No, his second.
His second full year, that's right. He played one game in 2013-2014 and got one goal. So, yeah, second full year, you're right. And it's, wow, it doesn't seem like second.
Yeah, he's
right.
Only played 115 games in the NHL, and he already has 100 points.
Almost a point per game pace already.
Yeah. By far the best of his entire draft class in 2011.
Yeah, and especially, I mean, I always look at it and say, this guy was a fourth-round pick. You know, like, to me, that still is amazing that he slipped that far just because of his height. But, you know, he's almost the next Theo Fleury.
Different style, but yeah, I can agree with that.
Different style, but that guy that is going to be the face of the team, the guy that everyone's going to get around, the guy that I think, you know, just like Theo, people still talk about, and I think we'll talk about Gaudreau long after he's gone.
Can't argue with that. It's just nice to be able to see another player of that caliber coming through the system.
It is, isn't it? And another homegrown guy. I have a soft spot in my heart for, you know, players that the Flames have drafted and developed and brought up through their own system as opposed to just go out and trade for the guy. I mean, really, in the end, it doesn't matter how the team's built if it wins, but I've always had a soft spot for those guys that come through our system. If you remember back in the day, the story behind Gaudreau, too, I mean, he didn't want to sign here, and the Flames kept getting him to sign, and eventually, I remember they sent, what, Conroy down there, and he got the big deal done, and it was all contingent on Gaudreau finishing school. So it was just, I don't know, it was a story right from the beginning that we got this guy signed, and he came in, and
yeah,
he's had the fanfare right since he started here, which I think is pretty cool, because most of the time, you just hear so-and-so signed. There's no story around it. We don't know if it was in a hotel room or he was in the bathtub or where he was, but he signed the contract and now he's a Flame.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Gaudreau is doing a great job with Monahan. I think in the past, Monahan to me has looked a little bit lost and like he didn't have that partner. And we know that Gaudreau is used to having, when he was in college, Bill Arnold there to be that setup man. And We were surprised last year when they separated those two at the beginning of the year, and we thought they'd play in the AHL together. But I think we've found the new setup man, and like you said, they've got to just bring the dump truck in and pay them whatever it takes to keep them both here.
Yeah, and realistically, the Flames, if they can find that third wheel to complete that line, that would be awesome. But that's easier said than done.
Yeah, and I think that third guy, too, doesn't have to be of the same caliber. Like, I think he's definitely got to be a good player, but I think with those two, you can fit a lot of different types of players on that other wing. And
sort of
that
like
line.
Vancouver with the Sedin twins, and you would just throw any random guy in there, and that guy would perform well.
Yeah, and we've seen Chicago do some of that, too.
Mm-hmm.
Changing up that winger, not necessarily some random guy, but changing up who that winger is, based on the team they're playing, based on the style they want to be in, that sort of thing. So anyway, it's exciting. The Flames are winning again. We're back in a playoff spot, which is nice. And I guess we never really left, right? After the Detroit game, we were in fifth.
Well, no, we're in fifth in the Pacific. So
okay,
yeah, it's one of those things. The winning streak, all it did was erase the first 2 months of bad hockey that the Flames played.
And now we've reset.
Yeah, and now it's a five-way race for the finish line.
When I look at this race for the finish line now, I look at it as, okay, the Flames have got themselves back in the conversation. Like you said, we reset our stupidity at the beginning. Now it's the Flames' spot to lose. If you look at the terrible division we're in, you know, the Flames, if they screw up and they can't keep stringing wins together, they're going to be out, and they probably deserve to be out. You know, they're not fighting back in anymore. It's their spot to hold on to.
Exactly. And if you look at the other teams, Vancouver is not a very good team. San Jose is not a very good team. Arizona has probably overperformed at this point, and Edmonton is having a surprisingly good season. So, realistically, the Flames should be able to beat at least three of those four teams.
Yeah.
If they're playing their game. Like, if they play as they have since the start of December, not necessarily getting the results, but just their level of play, they should be able to earn that playoff spot. It's just...
Yeah, and since we
seeing if they can do that.
Since we see strong teams who sort of muscle you out just because, you know, they're playing better than you. But like you said, we have a weak division. There's not a lot of teams I can see muscling us out unless we give up that spot.
Yeah. Well, the thing that I would actually set as the goal now that we've reset things is we have to go and beat the LA Kings and pass them and take the division. Because if you just set your goal as being a playoff team, well, you're already pretty much there right now. That's not really a goal to strive for. Mm-hmm. If you set your goals against LA and let's catch them, at least that gives you something to motivate yourself for.
For sure. You always want to look ahead. But I think, you know, as much as you definitely want to try and catch LA, you have to, if you look at the Flames and what we've seen from them this year, we have to just get them playing consistently the way they are first. And then
we're starting to see that,
we
too.
Are.
Like, we're starting to see all four lines playing effectively, not necessarily contributing offensively, but just not screwing up enough where the Flames lose, like, all their momentum. So, where earlier in the season, unless Gaudreau was out there, it was dicey. So... now the Flames are able to more consistently roll the four lines and take it to the other team.
While we're still talking about Gaudreau, Sportsnet noted last night, and I thought it was interesting, Gaudreau is the fifth fastest Flame to manage 100 points in franchise history. He's behind Joe Nieuwendyk, Sergei Makarov, Kerry Wilson, and Eddie Beers. Eddie Beers was not a name I expected to be on that list.
Yeah, well, you have to figure that three of the four names, Nieuwendyk, Wilson, and Beers, all did it in the 80s. And Gaudreau is only one game behind Beers and two behind Wilson. And Sergei Makarov was 32 at the time. So the only guy that clearly beat him was Joe Nieuwendyk. And, well,
and that's good company to be in.
Yeah.
So just sort of an interesting stat because, you know, Wilson and Beers are not names you think of when you think of distinguished Flames alumni.
No.
And Matt, you...
I don't even know if many Flames fans even know who those players are, to be honest.
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. And again, those guys were on a team in an era where it was a very good team like we're seeing now. And the Flames had, you know, depth throughout the lineup. So it was easier to get a lot of points because it wasn't a one- or two-line team.
Yeah, and then you add on the fact that it was the 80s where goal scoring was significantly better.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
We were talking earlier about the depth and the ability to roll four lines, and a couple of guys, we talked earlier about Michael Ferland and what we've seen from him. One of the guys that we saw last year when the Flames were rolling their lines who was very successful was Josh Jooris. Came out of nowhere last year, earned a spot with the team, had 24 points, 12 goals, and 12 assists in 60 games. This year we've seen Jooris struggling, and you and I have talked about it in the past. Jooris really, to me, now just looks like another run-of-the-mill bottom six guy. What did you think of him on the road trip?
Pretty much as you said, I thought his first game back, he played well. And then right after that, he faded into the woodwork.
He's played 23 games this year, 2 goals, 2 assists for 4 points, and he's a minus 4.
Yeah, and I thought Mason Raymond, like, he had a better streak over the homestand, the last one. But he's also fallen back to earth, and he's been looking like a player that should be in the press box as well.
Yeah, and I have to think that with Jooris, I mean, he's been given a chance because what we saw from him last year. But, I mean, he's signed as a free agent, wasn't drafted, never a guy that we really expected to see much from, if anything, at the NHL level. I think last year was a fluke, and I would be very surprised, honestly, if Jooris is a Flame come the start of next season.
I could see the Flames using him in a trade, possibly. But I would keep him around if they don't use him in that fashion. Because this year might just be a down year.
Who knows? I mean,
who knows? And see how he responds in training camp next year. If he does return to form, then you've got your good player again. If not, then you just move on and carry on with the next guy.
I think, too, though, for the type of player he was, and even the way we saw him last year, you're right, he could return to form, but there's other guys that we could bring in to replace him as well within our system. So, like you said, if they trade him, it's not like he's an asset we can't replace, like a Gaudreau or somebody like that. I think, you know what, if we have to move him because there's value there, there's 4 or 5 guys you could immediately bring up to take his spot.
That's the thing. When you're a rebuilding team, you need to have as many quality assets as possible because not everybody is going to succeed, and some might overachieve and then fall back to earth. Others might struggle, then pick it up. You don't know who's going to be in which category from day one. It sorts itself out. And
you can't keep everybody either.
No. And that's why you need to have like 20, 25 players throughout your organization that are quality guys. So that way the 8 or 9 that actually do figure it out and play well, you can keep those guys and then dismiss everybody else and carry on.
I guess if you're looking at it from a gamble perspective, which is really what a GM does. I mean, they don't have a crystal ball. They can't see the future. To me, I would be willing to gamble on moving Jooris. If we're looking to move somebody either to make room for a player to come up from the farm or we need an asset for a trade, I think he's a guy I would gamble on of having a low ceiling.
And I can agree with that. Back before he became the player last year that we saw, I compared him to a guy like Ben Street, somebody that's probably too good for the AHL, but not quite good enough to the NHL. And if he continues to struggle, he might end up being that same type of guy where he'll get cups of coffee here and there and not really have much of an impact.
See, I would more compare him to a guy, I think, like David Moss, or a guy even more like an Eric Nystrom. Not in their play style, but I think they're guys that every team needs a reliable bottom six guy. And Moss has been very fortunate to only really be with 2 organizations, but I think, you know, he's a guy that somebody's going to want in their organization somewhere. And I think even at the NHL level, I think he's going to get more than a cup of coffee. Because there's always these GMs that think, oh, I can make him better. I can do better. I can do that sort of thing. But, you know, you look like a guy like Nystrom who went from the Flames to the Wild to the Stars to the Predators. Like, somebody always wants you in their lineup. And I think you're going to see that from Jooris.
I can agree with that.
You know, he'll always, I think, be at the NHL level because I think he is too good for the A, but he's going to be a career 13th forward. I'm not comparing him to Moss or Nystrom in his play style, just sort of how his career's gone. And if you look at both those guys, they have good years and they have some poor years.
Yeah. As long as he can maintain his current play, he'll have a spot somewhere.
Yeah.
He just it's one of those things that there's not enough information yet. He might just have an early season struggle, sort of like Max Reinhardt did in Adirondack last year, and then he sorted it out after January. So you don't know quite yet exactly what he's doing. Just have to wait and see.
Yeah, but I would not be... I think if you're going to move a guy, especially a younger guy on this team, Jooris is probably the top of that list.
Yeah, exactly. If you can include him in a bigger trade, then you don't mind. So it's one of those things. It depends on what you're getting. Like if you're, say, getting offered a 6th-round pick for Jooris, I think you just keep him around. If you're making a bigger trade where, like, say you're getting Jonathan Bernier from Toronto, and he's one of the parts that goes the other way. Okay.
Yeah, he's not a guy we have to move. You don't just take the first deal the GM makes you for him. I mean, he's not like Hudler where we don't want him to walk for nothing. But yeah, I think you're right. You can keep him here. He's not doing any harm being on the roster. And if we can move him and make, you know, that asset turn into greater value, then yeah, let's move him. Well, Matt, if we look over the last week of the Flames, yeah, we won some on the road, but I don't know. If you look at the whole week and even the way the team played, I would say, I don't know about you, the road woes are continuing.
Yeah, I think that in the first 7 or 8 minutes of each game, they struggled to find a way to make adjustments to the other team. And unfortunately, in a couple of those games, they surrendered the first and second goal. And
during that time,
it's one of those things that as we progress into January, the Flames only play 5 games in the Saddle Dome in January out of, I think, 13 games. So they're going to have a lot of games on the road. They have to win, especially because it's an easier stretch next month where they're playing mostly subpar teams. They're going to have to find a way to get points in order to secure a playoff spot. And you can't have games where you're just not showing up for the first 8-10 minutes.
And January is really the exception there. If you look at the schedule, February and March, we have a lot of home games coming up. And lots of, like in March, we have a 2-week home stretch, which is going to be good. But yeah, you're right. We can't go into an away game and play a different game than we would at home. It can't matter what building you're in. You've got to play the same game. And I think, in a way, it's good that we have so many road games in January because it gives us time to iron that out. But at the same time, I'm worried about it because we can't just say, oh, we'll make it back up when we get home. Like, you know, we have to be able to be consistent and start off knowing who we're playing and what they're going to do. And like you said, be ready to go right at the beginning.
Mm-hmm. It'll be interesting to see how the Flames adjust over this next stretch. It seemed like the first 2 months they were struggling to get anything going correctly. And in December, even though they won most of the games thus far, there's been inconsistencies even in the games that they've won. So until last night, actually, the Winnipeg game was the first time pretty much all season they played great from puck drop to the final buzzer. And the Flames need to find that consistency where they're playing even 50-55 minutes in a game consistently and weathering the storm when the other team does get opportunities.
And like you said, they're not coming out strong at the beginning, but I'm also finding on the road they're often seeming... Yeah, like the opportunities are often there, especially in the first period, and we're just not capitalizing on them. We're letting ourselves get behind early.
Yeah, and that's not exactly a recipe for success. The Flames have been known to be able to have those late game comebacks, but you don't want to be putting yourself in a situation where you need to do that.
No, and that's it. If we want to be a playoff team, we don't want to be securing that last minute. We need to be playing consistently, really, from here to the end of the year, or I think this is going to slip away from us.
And especially this is the stretch to do it. And if you include the Jets game, the 22-game stretch from that game right through till February 15th, the Flames only play 5 of the 22 games against teams that are currently in the top half of the standings. So you're basically playing all weak teams or weaker teams for this next stretch. This is the time that the Flames basically need to win like 15 or 16 or 17 of these 22 games and put themselves pretty much like right up there with LA. So that way, when they hit the back end of February and March, where they're playing a little bit more against tougher teams, that they have that cushion. So if they do struggle in those months, they have a little bit of a buffer.
For sure. And like you said, we have some of the lesser teams in the league, if you will, coming in the next little bit. And I think that's an opportunity for us if we use it correctly, because it's like, okay, we have these lesser teams, so it gives us that chance to try and not so much worry about playing to an elite team, but just keeping the game on track. You know, you're
sort of like how they managed the game against the Jets. Just keep doing your thing.
Exactly. You're not always
trying
to... You can
control the play. The other team's not good enough where they're going to beat you single-handedly. You have to screw up in order for them to win. So if you just manage your game and you play it your way, you should be able to come out with 2 points.
And even going on the road to say, okay, we're in their building. Yes, it's not at home. We're not wearing red, but yeah, we can manage this. We can do it. You know, these guys are ours to beat. So I think it's going to be a really interesting month to see what happens in January, if this was a flash in the pan or if this continues. And I think January is really the turning point. By this time next month, I think we're going to know if this team is for real or if this team was a fluke of a success.
Well, realistically, the Flames, by this time next month, they should be in not only in a playoff spot, they should likely be in home ice and have a buffer on the last playoff spot.
Yeah.
If they're even in the same spot where they are now battling with the other teams, I think you can pretty much kiss the playoff chances away. And we'll see. It's one of those situations that it's in the room. And if they are good enough to be a playoff team, they will earn it. If they're not, they won't.
We've shown that we can do it. We've shown we can play hockey to an elite level in the league this year. It's a matter of how consistently does this group of guys want to do that. In my mind, that's what it's breaking down to. I mean, we've shown that we can do it. We've shown we can beat the best teams. We can go on a win streak. We can win night after night. So it's just a matter of the mental part. Like you said, it's in the room. It's, does this group of guys want this bad enough?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not like we're the Oilers of last year trying to say, okay, we want it, but the physical talent isn't there. We have all the pieces that we need to make it to the Stanley Cup playoffs. We just need to want it bad enough.
And that will show itself. We're just at a point where there's not enough information. The Flames have only been playing consistently for the last 10 games. And they were struggling for like the first 23, 24 games. So,
that's it. October was a terrible month. November was a terrible month. December is really the only time that they've come around. And it seems like people are erasing the first 2 months from their memory.
Things could easily turn back to the first 2 months. You don't know. And
no, and history this season leads us to believe it probably will.
And who knows? It will depend entirely on their mental fortitude. And they have enough talent where they should be a playoff team. If they want it bad enough, they'll get it. And that's it.
Why don't we move on from that? Because we really don't have any answers. I guess it's just wait and see what happens in January and what this team does. But we were mentioning earlier some of the changes that Kerry Ramo's made. And we'll post some pictures of this, sort of the new look compared to Kipper's look, in the show notes on firesidechat.ca. But Matt, Ramo debuted some new pads in the Nashville game, and before this, he was wearing just plain white pads. They had no design on them. In fact, there's even a place in the stitching, if you look closely, where the design, like the color should be, and he never got it filled in. It almost looks like an uncolored coloring book. And now the pads he's wearing are eerily similar to those worn by Mika Kiprusoff.
And he's played significantly better in net since he made the change. Maybe he's channeling in his favorite goaltender.
I had to look twice at first. I thought maybe his pads didn't arrive in Nashville properly, and they had a pair of Kipper pads, you know, in an equipment bag somewhere, and they strapped these on, but they're different pads. I mean, they're not the same pad, but they're pretty darn close.
Yeah, and in that Jets game, he made one play when the Matthew Perreault penalty expired, and he, like, dove across to make the splits save. It looked very reminiscent of Kipper, so if he can start channeling in his inner Mika, then that would be awesome for the Flames moving forward.
And he changed his mask, too. It's nowhere near as cool as Mika's mask was, but he's gotten a darker mask, which is eerily similar of Kipper as well.
Nice to see him making some changes, shaking it up a bit.
Well, and I know I was reading somewhere a while ago, because there's this trend now in the NHL of goalies going with mostly white pads. You know, they're either all white, like Kipper's, or there's very little design on it. And I remember reading somewhere that it was some research study was done that if the pad is white, it's harder for the shooter to know where the leg is as opposed to the ice, which makes sense when you think about it. It's harder for them to target the five hole. And you look at guys like Hiller who wear black and red pads, it's a lot easier to see. But even before we went on the air tonight, you and I were talking about how even these new pads, they look so generic these days. Like, it's just a template where they color in whatever color team you play for. And back in the 90s, we used to have some of the coolest pads. I mean, there was, you know, I still remember my favorite pair of Flames pads was Trevor Kidd's pads with the fire coming up the bottom. He's still got my favorite Flames mask, I think. We were looking at Kevin Weeks where he had the gargoyles almost on his pads. Like, I wonder if that's going to be a renaissance again that we're going to see come back over the next couple of years. What do you think?
Yeah, like even when Kelly Rudy was with the San Jose Sharks, he had the shark on his pads. Just some really interesting designs. And I don't know. I don't see there being that much of a difference, really. So why not go with a more artistic style and make it customized like your mask? And tailor it to what you want instead of just being generic.
Yeah, I mean, I can see there being a difference, but I bet if you were to look at the stats, it's probably no more than maybe, you know, 2 goals a season.
If that.
And so,
like, the difference, like, say the shooting percentage is like 0.04% better, that's what, 1 goal every 250 shots? Like, give me a break.
Yeah, no, it's not a whole lot better, but yeah, I don't know. It seems like, yes, they're cool pads that Ramo's gotten. Again, we'll post a picture of them at firesidechat.ca in our show notes for episode 102, but they're still generic looking. Like, I just wish we would go back to pads that looked cool and meant something to the team you're with, and also helmets like that too. Like, again, you look at these helmets these guys are wearing, the goalie masks, and they're not the, I guess, the symbolism you used to have. You used to have one mask that had a strong, you know, image to it. I think of something like Belfour's or Cujo's or Hextall. And now you've got all these little pictures all over. It's like a big collage or scrapbook. And, you know, we've got, what, Edgar Allan Poe poetry on Ramo's mask?
Yeah. I know. And, like, I always liked in the 90s that when you had guys like, say, Felix Potvin, every time he'd change teams, he would just alter the base color, not the actual design. And I thought that was always interesting.
Belfour cool. Did the same.
Yeah. And there was a lot of personal identity with the masks. Now it's, especially ever since Dave Art started making most of the masks around the league, I thought the quality of the masks dropped significantly. And now everything's kind of generic looking and bland.
I think, too, if you look at the difference, back in the 90s, the mask was almost designed to mean something to the shooter coming in on you. It was, evil looking. At you know, when you looked up at the goaltender, he looked evil. And now I think it's more about artwork for the goalie, or you know, stuff the goalie likes. And it's like, you don't see your own mask. Put that on the inside if you want that. If you want a quote or something like that. But they don't look as intimidating. You know, go online over the Christmas break here and look up Felix Potvin. Look up Eddie Belfour. Like, as a skater, it was intimidating.
Yeah, I agree. And it's a lot more boring now, really. Like, if you look around most of the league, a lot of the masks are just sort of more like a street hockey mask, where it's very generic. Like, okay, it's a New York Rangers mask. Well, we'll incorporate a little bit of the Statue of Liberty in that, and that's about it. Like, there's not a lot of creativity there.
No, and, well, I don't know. I wouldn't say there's not as much creativity, but I think it's an artist trying to give you a collage, right? Like you said, in New York, it's, let's put the Statue of Liberty on, let's put these buildings. And there was some goalie, I forget who it was, that had a big apple on his mask. Like, it's more about the city and more about, you know, what's cool to that goalie than, you know, what makes a cool mask that fits the team theme but is just nasty looking.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I always remember, as much as I don't like him as a goalie, one of the masks that I really liked was actually Curtis McElhaney's mask here. It had, like, the flaming skulls and sort of that skull that was a cowboy on the side. And it just, it fit Calgary with the cowboy theme well, but it just, it screamed Flames to me.
Yeah, exactly. And now it's been a departure. Like, even with Kipper, his flaming skulls, that was an intimidating mask. Now most of them are just bland.
Yeah, so I don't know. I'm hoping that we're going to see in the next couple of years some sort of a resurgence of that sort of, I would call it the artisan, I don't know, the artisan goalie pad, the stuff that's really not so much about telling the goalie story. I don't want to say I don't care, but, you know, I don't really care what your favorite poetry quote is. You know, I really don't care your, you know, any of that stuff that we're seeing on the mask now. Like, just give me something nasty and intimidating that looks like some that team should wear. Something with fire on it. Something with, you know, like the cowboy for Calgary. I think we just need to get back to simplifying one image, not, you know, a whole collage that's just nasty.
Mm.
And intimidating and scary. And, you know, like you were talking about Kippers, and he had the skulls on it, and he kept changing the colors on that, if you remember. It was white, and then it had a red background, and then it had the black background, but it was very distinctly him. And there's not too many goalies in the league anymore that I can say distinctively what their artwork is.
Yeah, it's mostly generic stuff. And plus, goalies are now changing masks up like 3-4 times a season, it seems.
It almost becomes more of a marketing gimmick. You'd almost think they were selling the mask to the fans, where it's like, let's use 9 different masks just because then we can sell them.
Yeah, they're not, but that's what it comes off like.
Yeah, like even I remember a mask I didn't really like, but Patrick Lalime used to wear Marvin the Martian on his mask, and at least it was him.
Yeah.
You know, it was that piece of imagery that you knew was him. I remember Tebow had a mask I hated, Justin Tebow in Montreal, but it was him. It was uniquely him, and we're not seeing enough masks now where...
Yeah, or even Theodore with the gargoyles on it. And when he went to Colorado, he had them, like, frozen, you know, instead of like they were in Montreal. And that was his characteristics. And, yeah, it's just the goalies seem to have gotten away from that, and it's disappointing.
And even a guy like Roman Turek, who had the same characters, the Iron Maiden characters, they were in different poses and different looks, but they were always there. That was his thing.
Yeah.
And, yeah, it just seems now like it's just a very generic, okay, we need a mask for this guy. Like you said, let's put some cowboys on it if it's Calgary, and we'll put his favorite piece of poetry or something like that. And it's just, I don't know, it's, to me it's sad. It's I want something that, I guess, shows off the team, both for the pads and the mask, and not just something very generic. If we're going to do that, let's just all look like Hiller and just wear black masks.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, here's an interesting statistic. To go back to our Gaudreau conversation, he has 3 hat tricks already, and he is now 4th by a Flame since 93-94. Ginla had 12 hat tricks, Fleury had 7, Gary Roberts had 5, and then it's Gaudreau tied with Rene Bourque, Mike Camilleri, and Curtis Glencross. Nice. So he's already getting up that roster board, leaderboard quickly as well.
That's going to be a lot more names that Flames fans know on that list that you just gave us, and again, a lot more elite company.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Matt, anything else you want to chat about this week?
Nothing much other than just the weekly predictions for until the next time we talk on January 4th.
Yeah, we're going to take some time off over Christmas. It'll be January 2016 by the time we come back. And as usual, we'll do our weekly predictions. Our weekly predictions are brought to you by TickTix. TickTix connects the Sea of Red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so that buyers don't get ripped off. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to pick them up. Download TickTix today in the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. The Flames doing great. Everyone's going to want to see them. Everyone should try to get to the Dome to see them. And if you want to see them on the great run they're on, use TickTick to buy those last-minute tickets for Christmas or just to get yourself to the Dome to watch this team, because it's a lot of fun being there right now.
Yeah, and 7 of the next 8 games are in the Saddle Dome, so
lots
plenty
of
opportunity
to get out there.
Yep.
Looking at our predictions from last week, we had 10 points on the board. I thought we'd walk away with 5 of them. I thought we'd win Nashville, Winnipeg, and we'd get 1 point in an overtime loss to Detroit. You had 4 points with just Nashville, Winnipeg. We were both technically right on the wins, but we didn't anticipate the Dallas win. So Calgary got 6 possible points. They beat Nashville, they beat Winnipeg, and they beat Dallas. So still, Matt, for the, I think, the 6th week now, it's 2-1 in favor of you as far as our season totals.
We were really, really bad at predicting.
Last year we did great. This year it's all over the place.
Well, you know, it is a testament to the Flames. They've been a little bit all over the place as well. So
they have. The next games we have, we finish off our 3-game homestand after the league comes back from Christmas. They're off till the 27th. They play the Oilers here in the Dome on the 27th. They play the Ducks here in the Dome on the 29th. And the New Year's Eve game against the Los Angeles Kings, also at the Dome. If you want to go to that New Year's Eve game, it's a lot of fun. Again, use TickTick. They'll hook you up with some tickets for that. TickTick is on the App Store for whatever phone you use. And then on the 2nd, we travel not too far away to Colorado for a single road game before we come back home again. So we've got 4 games in the docket for this week's predictions. We have Edmonton. We've got the Ducks here. We have the Kings, and we have the Colorado Avalanche. Matt, you want to go first?
Yeah, I'm going to go with 6 points. I think that they're going to beat Edmonton and Colorado and figure out a way to beat one of Anaheim or LA.
Okay, so you're guaranteeing an Edmonton-Colorado win in your predictions? And
I'll go with the New Year's Eve game. I think they'll beat the Kings.
The Kings?
Yeah.
And that sort of goes to what you were saying earlier, right? If we can, even if we can't necessarily match the Kings in their standings yet, if we can start beating them and show that we're of an equal level or better to them, that's going to go a long way to helping this team move up as well.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking at the games. We better beat Edmonton. At this point, if we're contending for a playoff spot, we better beat Edmonton. We've had some mixed success so far against them. I think we're going to beat Edmonton. I think we're going to beat the Kings. And I think, how have we done against Colorado this year?
We lost the first game in November 6-1, I do believe. So.
All right, I'm going to go 4 points. I think we're going to beat Edmonton, and I think we're going to beat LA.
All
right. I think that the Flames are strong right now with the win streak, but I wouldn't be surprised if the time off might slow them down a bit. And I think the Ducks should be an easy win right now, but I wouldn't be surprised, just knowing the Ducks, if
If it was any other team, I would say that the Flames would beat them, but it's Anaheim, and for whatever reason, the Flames just have a hard time, so...
Yeah, they have a hard time against the Ducks. I don't think, as much we should beat the Ducks with where they are this year, I think the Ducks are going to beat us, and I think Colorado is going to find a way to beat us. We, ever since Jerome's moved to Colorado, we seem to have struggled with them.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully you're right, because we need the points right now, but it's 6 points and 4 points on the board, and we'll see who's right when we come back in 2016.
Yep. Have a good holiday season, Dan.
Yeah, thanks, Matt. You too, and thanks, everybody, for listening again through another calendar year. It's crazy that 2015 is already coming to an end, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, hopefully everybody has a better 2016, both in terms of the economy and watching the Calgary Flames.
Yeah, I'm hoping that Calgary as a whole, I think, is going to be a very different place in 2016. And I think that the Flames are going to be one of the things that's going to bind this city together in the new year. So I'm hoping that the Flames can sort of put that effort up that we need for them to be that force.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just as always, when it's holiday time, drink responsibly. Don't drink and drive. Use Uber or any other taxi service if you're out and drinking. So
we
that
want
way,
everybody to be here for episode 103 in 2016.
Yes, and just have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you, and Happy New Year to everybody listening. Talk to you in the new year, Matt.
Take care, everybody. Bye.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.